So recording should now be going. Welcome to everyone who is joining us via the recording on YouTube. We are discussing computing derivatives this week. Correct me if I'm wrong, but we did sections 2.3, 2.4, and 2.5. So if we want to just start doing some problems, or if you have some questions that you want to ask, then we can just, you know, get started. All right. So I'm currently on page one. Oh, I can't hear you. I should be able to hear you. My audio is, volume is up. Are you, check to make sure that you're not muted. Not muted. Huh. Are you trying to? Yeah. Let me check to make sure my audio is working correctly. Or my speaker. My speaker should be on. Can you say something?
Check, yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Okay. Yeah. We're on board now.
Oh, awesome. I was going to say, it's going to make it so much easier than to...
Yeah, and then to use the chat.
behind what you're speaking.
Okay. All right. So welcome. Yes. I was. It is 2.3 through 2.5 this week, correct? Okay. Do you just want to start 2.?
Please, yeah. Not to like throw you a curveball, but so I'm... basically like just go over anything as a review.
Okay.
There's no particular one thing. It's I'm having a bit of a go at it, so
okay,
wherever you would start is fine.
Yeah, sounds good. Let's start in 2.3 and work our way up. So this is, I'm on page right now 140.
So I'm going to do my best to go along with you. Here's the other thing, is the version of the book I have, I don't think corresponds to the instruction. So I have the variable calculus early transcendentals edition, which I don't think perfectly corresponds. So
okay.
I'll just go to 2.3.
Okay. Yeah. I think the title of this is differentiation formulas.
I'm going to have to move to match you, because my 2.3 is calculating limits using limit laws.
Okay. I think I might have seen the edition that you have. I don't think the sections are exactly the same in this like span of like sections. So go to the one right before like trigonometric functions. And I think, do you have like, I think there's like product and quotient rule as like a section.
It's all a blur, so I'm going to have to try and find it here real quick. So it's not the limit of a function. Tangent and velocity. Limit laws? The limit laws, right?
No, we're in computing derivatives. Mm-hmm.
Besides the definition of a limit. See, maybe that's the source of part of my okay. What's the section called?
The section is called differentiation formulas, but I think older books or like a different edition of the book. I've got two editions too.
Okay.
But one of them is like really bootleg. But the older, the other one, the one that is not being used by the class right now, doesn't have that exact heading differentiation formulas. It splits it up, I think, into, let's see, that is not it.
So you said the section before trigonometric.
What sections do you have in chapter 3?
In chapter 3, let's see here. So it starts with, so chapter 3 is the differentiation rules?
Yeah, so that's where we want to be.
Okay, all
right. So what we're doing right now will correspond to your 3.1 and 3.2, I think, so which is...
derivatives of polynomials in exponential functions?
Yeah, and... the product and quotient rules. And I'm pretty sure that 2.3 in the book that we're using in class is kind of like those two like smashed together almost.
Okay, got it.
I've been using
online as much as possible, which is why like don't take my confusion with the actual text as like, oh my gosh, what is he doing?
Because I use
the computer for drawing my lessons.
Okay.
I think I'm there.
Yeah. So I think the problems are a little off. They're not exactly the same, but I think the problems are like off like via their numbering, but the problems should be pretty similar.
Got it.
Okay. So I'm gonna write down some problems and then we're gonna talk about them. And I have it at half screen because I have to have the book open also, because I unfortunately have like the online version, which,
you gotta split it.
Yeah, I have to have a split screen. So sorry about that. So let's start with number one, which is going to be f of x is equal to 2 to the 40th power. And then let's also do number three, which is f of x is equal to 5.2x plus 3.3. Okay. So our task here is to differentiate the function. So we're going to find these derivatives. What do you think about number one?
Okay. So I do, the one piece I can recall off the top of my head is the power rule.
Mm-hmm.
So if we, I think.
Give me like a basic example of the power rule. Like what does a power rule look like?
Sure, okay, maybe I'm a little off. Okay, so if we had x to the 40th, we would take 40, put it in front of x, and then take the power minus 1, and that would be the exponent, so 40x to the power 49.
Okay. So that being said, what do we have here?
Okay, so we have 2 to the 40th. We don't have a variable. We don't have x. So... I don't know if that means we can presume that x is to the 0.
Well, we don't even have, like, we don't even have x, like, happening at all.
Right, we don't have x at all. Okay.
And so this is kind of a trick question, because this is a constant.
Okay, the derivative of a constant is 0?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, yeah. You're good.
All over the place. I have written in my notes,
mm-hmm.
I hit this block right here, only to come to the realization that a derivative of a constant is 0.
Mm-hmm.
In like bold letters on whatever page I'm writing on. So I do remember the derivative of a constant is a 0.
Awesome.
Let's just for this example right here.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get to 2 to the 40th being 0?
Okay. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to say we want to take a derivative with respect to x. So I'm going to erase some of this so we have a little bit more space. And I'm going to say we covered this notation. So I'm going to say the derivative with respect to x of 2 to the 40th is equal to what? And the answer is going to be I have to find out where x is in this equation. Because, for instance, if I had this equation, so 2 to the 40th times x, I would be able to say that here is my x. I'm differentiating with respect to x, so I'm going to end up with 2 to the 40th. However, because there is no x here, I can't differentiate with respect to x. It's just a constant, and that's all that I can consider it as.
Is this kind of like if we were to graph a constant, there is no slope, the slope is zero.
Exactly.
And the derivative of a line with slope zero, there is no slope, so it is zero.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Okay. That's awesome that you're connecting graph and algebra.
Because it's a trick question. You see the exponent, you're like, oh, what is an exponent? It's still, there's no variable. Okay.
Awesome.
Okay.
All right. What about number 3?
A little bit of what we just went over and the first one. So we would take the derivative of each of those values. So the derivative of 3.3, that's a constant. So that's zero.
Mm-hmm.
And so then we're left with just taking the derivative of 5.2. 5.2x.
Mm-hmm.
So the derivative of x to the first is really x to the zero, which is 1. So we're just left with 5.2.
Mm-hmm. And another way to think about this is if this is a line, this is in y is equal to mx plus b form, and there's your m.
Oh, okay, all right. So got it.
So our derivative is just going to be 5.2, just a one number.
And that's another thing, too, that learning all the terminology up front.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, you can say derivative is slope.
Yes.
Right? Okay.
The derivative is going to be the slope of the tangent line at a given point.
Got it.
More specifically. But yeah, the derivative is going to be slope. So we will get into that, I think, a little bit later.
Okay.
But for now, we're just finding general equations because the concept of a derivative is that can I find an equation that represents the slope of the tangent line at any given point?
Okay.
So at any point on this line, if we were to have a line that looks like this with a slope of 5.2 and a y-intercept of 3.3, at any point on this line, the slope is going to be 5.2 of the line that's tangent to the curve.
Got it, because there's no curve.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah, the slope is going to be the same no matter what point.
Yep.
Okay. All right, that part I think I have a fair grasp on.
Awesome. All right. Let's do number 5. So we have f of t is equal to 2t cubed minus 3t squared minus 4t. So again, we're taking the derivative with respect to x. So what am I looking at for f prime?
I don't know if that was an open-ended, if you're going to go through it or if you want me to.
You can jump in whenever you want. I'll ask questions, but if there's a huge gap, then I can just move on or whatever.
Okay.
Just feel free to say, like, give me a second if you want to work through it.
Sure. Okay. Okay, I guess I'll just, so I think with this, you just, you're just going to take the derivative of each unit.
Mm-hmm.
So, right, so t to the third would be 3 times 2, 6. And then take 1 off the exponent, so t to the second.
Mm-hmm.
And then 2 times 3, because we're taking the exponent, and then t to the first, just t. And then, so t to the first would be 1 times 4, then t to the 1 minus 1 would just be 1.
Mm-hmm.
It would just be 4. And then just, I guess, yeah, just multiply, and then 60 minus 4, yeah, and that's.
All right. How about number 9, which is different in your book? So it is.
I'm pretty much going to rely, like, solely on whatever you put on put on there, just because I know mine's not going to be quite in line.
So what do you think about this one?
Okay. So I feel like we want to do a conversion first. Well, no, maybe not. Okay, so we could just take negative 3/4 times, put that at the beginning, multiplied by 2, and then subtract 1 off of that, which would be negative 7/4.
Exactly. Okay. Negative 3/4 minus 4/4. We're going to end up with negative 6/4 t to the negative 7/4. So g prime of t is going to be negative 3/2 t to the negative 7/4.
Got it.
The important takeaway from this one is just if you have a fraction up here that you're going to work with, you can still subtract 1 on the fraction. Isn't going to make that big of a difference.
Okay.
Just work around it.
Sure.
So it's a similar experience for problem 13. It's purple. Which looks like this. So, what is the first thing that you would do when kind of starting to solve this problem?
Okay, so, and I'll tell you, really helpful when someone's actually prompting you to walk through it, which is really weird. Like, if I was looking at this, I might not know what to do, but, so, I feel the first thing would be, convert, the square root of p, change it to exponent form.
Exactly, yep.
P to the 1/2.
Awesome.
And then from there we can do the same thing. So 1/2 p to the negative 1/2 minus 1.
Perfect.
Okay.
Awesome. That is exactly it. So yep. First things first is get the square root sign out of the way, turn that into an exponent so you actually know how to work with it.
Right.
And then just go ahead and treat it like any like power type role problem.
Okay.
Let's see. This.
Now, are there ones? Sorry, not to.
Go ahead.
So these ones I feel that I'm getting the core concept of them. I think, mm-hmm. like, when I get tripped up, it's, like, t take the, in this, we might be getting to this, but, you know, find the derivative of, like, fractions within fractions that have exponents, like, that becomes, like, a
thing. Do you want to try something like 17?
Let me see if I can.
Oh, you don't have the same number. Sorry.
I think you said that you found it, so I don't want to, I want to see if maybe, no, okay, so I actually, if I look at exercises for 3.1 in my book,
mm-hmm.
one you just did, which is S of P is square root of P minus P,
mm-hmm.
is that 17 for you, or is that something else?
It's 13 for me. Okay, here, I think I can pull up the other.
No, that's I'll go off of whatever.
Nope, I have the other book right here. So I think I have the same version as you, because that same problem we just did is number 17 in this version.
Okay.
So what about, let me look for the right, what about problem 23? Is that the kind of problem that you?
Yeah, so getting into that, yeah. And then just looking further down the road too, like when we get things with the derivatives of having the like the trigonometric,
yeah,
and then that adds a few layers for me, but we can look at this. Let's look at this.
Okay. So basically in this section we learned a couple of rules for differentiation. So this is 23 in the book that you have. This is 17 in the book that I think is otherwise being used. And that is y is equal to x squared plus 4x plus 3 over the square root of x.
Yes.
So what rule, when looking at this, is like your first like gut instinct, like this is the rule that we...
Like first knee-jerk reaction to this is
mm-hmm.
the quotient.
Yeah. I think there... sorry, the book that I have comes with solutions with your numbers in it. So I'm looking at the solution here, and it doesn't recommend using the quotient rule. It actually recommends just simplifying. But I agree with you, my gut reaction was quotient rule.
Yeah, okay.
So I upon looking at the solution, I was like, yes, definitely. But quotient rule is also my knee-jerk reaction. Yeah.
What the solution says, could we convert square root of x and flip it to the numerator? I don't know if that was part of.
Well, we can have each of these separated, right? So we'll have x squared over x to the 1/2
okay.
plus 4x over x to the 1/2. Plus 3 over x to the 1/2. And the reason we can do this is because, I mean, like, it's going to make it easier. Because then I can write this as y is equal to, what would this be if I have x squared divided by x to the 1/2?
Got it.
In terms of rule of exponents.
X to the 1/2.
This.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Nope, you're good.
Is not doing correct arithmetic in my head. X to the 3/2.
Mm-hmm. And so this is going to be 4x to the what?
To the 1/2.
Yep. And this is going to be.
That one. Okay. Hold on. I guess if you could assume that there is an invisible x to the 0 up there, then you could say that it's x to the negative 1/2?
Yeah. Oh. You can also say that if x 1 over x to the 1/2 is equal to x to the negative 1/2,
oh.
then this is just times 3. But exactly.
Okay.
So we end up with this, which we then can solve using the power rule instead of the quotient rule, like both of our knee-jerk reactions too.
Okay.
So... Sorry, I just got out of a session where I, like, screwed up, like, majorly on a very simple problem, so I'm, like, Kofta. So just a reminder that I do make mistakes sometimes, and that there are sometimes easier ways to solve things than I sometimes go about it. But
that's the glorious and the also maddening thing.
Yep.
One person's way is not another person's way.
So this is probably the easiest way to solve this problem. So we can just say that y prime is equal to, this will be 3/2 x to the half.
Okay, yeah.
Plus 4 times 1/2 yeah. times x. What is this power?
Negative.
Yep. And then what is this? Mm-hmm. So this is 3/2 x to the half plus 2 x to the negative 1/2 minus 3/2 x to the negative 3/2. And that is the derivative for this problem.
Yeah, that makes a lot more sense.
All right. Let me see. I'm going to match up some of these numbers, maybe, possibly. I'm not going to match up these numbers, actually, because they're split up in this book.
Sure.
Oh. So I'm going to move on to your section 3.2.
Okay.
And we're going to start with question 7 for you.
Now, is this in, so, okay, so jump to the exercises for...
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this is still section 2.3 for everyone else, and it'll be problem 29, but for you it is going to be number 7.
And I keep checking, I've never done this, I know you're recording, I keep checking, I'm the only person still in here.
yeah, that happens sometimes nobody shows, sometimes like 7 people show up, it really just depends.
I guess if no one's in here, right?
Well, I still record something. So
problems and stuff.
Yeah, it's not always like exactly like the longest experience. But it is some practice problems.
Got it. Okay, cool.
Okay.
Okay.
So this is our problem, number 29. Now what do you think that we're going to use to solve this problem? Yes, exactly. Here, if we were to split it up, it would not make it easier, because we would split it into 3 minus 4 over x and then plus 2 x over 3 minus 4 over x. We couldn't get rid of any x's. We couldn't make it simpler. That would just be annoying. So instead, we're going to do the quotient rule. And so what is the quotient rule?
In like for the numerator, well, okay, sorry. So
when you're solving a problem using the quotient rule or the product rule, what is the first thing that you should do?
So this is, we're taking the derivative of the denominator times the numerator minus
the derivative. Yeah.
Denominator times
the first thing that I would do is I would say, what are the functions I'm working with? Because by the definition of the quotient rule, we're taking the derivative of a function divided by a function, right? So I'm going to split this into f of x is equal to 1 plus 2x. And then I'm going to call this one h of x. I think in the book they call it g of x, but I have a g here. So I'm just going to split these up real quick. So I can say that I have 2 different functions. I can go ahead right now and figure out what f prime of x is going to be. It's going to be...
One?
It's going to be 2.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, the one drops off because
the one drops off, the two sticks around. What about for H? What is H prime going to be?
Okay, so this is going to be just -4.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now I have that situated. I know that I have something of the form F over H, and I want to take the derivative of this. This is going to turn into something that looks like this, right? This is the rule. F prime, I'm gonna get rid of it, of X. So F prime times H minus H prime times F over H squared.
Right, okay.
So, what I've kind of done is broken this into, I'm not gonna confuse myself by thinking about okay, so this is the denominator, this is the numerator. I'm gonna explicitly, I do this every time I solve a problem, even if it's this simple via the quotient rule or the product rule or the chain rule, as we're gonna learn later on, because I at least get confused very easily. And writing it all down allows me to go back and say, this is where I messed up.
Right, okay, got it.
So I'm gonna put this together. If I wanna find the derivative of F over H, in this case, the derivative of G of X, so G prime of X, it's going to be equal to F prime times H. F prime, I decided it is 2. So that'll be 2 times H of X, which is going to be 3 minus 4X.
Okay, yeah.
And then I'm going to be minus H prime, so minus negative 4 times F of X. So 1 plus 2X all over H squared. So 3 minus 4x squared.
Okay.
Does it make sense what I just did?
Yeah, I gotta tell you, the one thing that, kind of began to put these pieces together for me is that the thing where you started, where you established f of x and mm-hmm. f of x, I was going into, all right, I take the derivative of 1 plus 2x multiplied by 3 minus 4x minus the derivative of, mm-hmm. I was taking those quantities and trying to figure,
Yeah, it's so hard to do in your head and put it together. I would not recommend that.
Yeah, no, just, taking that step makes it so much easier because you have a value for the derivative already.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can start multiplying them. Yeah, okay.
All right, so we have, just to simplify this now, this will end up being 2 times 3, 6, minus 8x, minus, this will be negative 4 minus 8x, over 3 minus 4x squared. This will be 6 minus 8x plus 4 plus 8x. So G prime of X will be negative 8X plus 8X will be 0. And then 6 plus 4 will be 10 over 3 minus 4X squared.
Got it.
And yeah.
That's perfect.
So. All right. Do you want to try another one with the quotient rule?
I think we can push on to the...
Okay. Then let's quick do... there is one that I wanted to do last in this section. And it is going to be... I'm not sure where it is in this book. I'm not seeing it immediately popping up. But I'm going to write it down. And it is a quotient rule problem. It's just a little bit more application. It is problem 51, not really application. It wants you to find the equation of the tangent line at the curve at the given point. So, first things first, we establish tangent line, the equation of a tangent line to the curve is going to be the derivative.
Yes.
So that's like definition of the derivative.
Yes.
So in order to find the equation of the tangent line at a given point, we just need the equation of the tangent line. In this case, it is going to be we're going to just find y prime. So if y is equal to this, then one of our equations is going to be f of x is equal to 2x. The other one is going to be g of x is equal to x plus 1.
Yeah.
So f prime is equal to what?
Yes. Okay, so f prime is just going to be 2.
Mm-hmm. G prime is going to be?
The 1 drops off and the x becomes 1, so 1.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then we can put them together. We can say that this is y prime is equal to, we have f prime times g. So just write it out again, f prime g minus g prime f over g squared is going to be y prime. So y prime will be f prime times g, so 2. Times x plus 1 minus g prime times f to 2x all over g squared. Put it together just like we did the last one. So we can simplify. 2x plus 2 minus 2x over x plus 1 squared. So y prime of x equals, these are going to cancel out. We're going to end up with 2 over x plus 1 squared. Okie doke. So this is where we're at right now. Now we need to find the equation of the line at the given point. So we have this equation of the line, but this is a general condition. In order to find it at a given point, we need to put, my brain just totally blanked. We need to put.
I don't think it's the same problem in my book. Do they provide a point?
Yes. Sorry. Yeah. It is 0.11.
Okay.
So we know that what is the case for which let's find the slope basically of the line, right? That's like what we're looking for. How are we going to find the slope of that line?
Well, so we have the derivative, which is the 2 over x plus 1 squared.
Mm-hmm. And what we, I think I probably did not say this like clearly earlier. Sure. What this is, yeah,
okay.
Exactly.
Okay, yeah, that's what I thought. I just want to make sure. So, so when we have, so is what we want to do, if we want to find the slope, do we want to put, plug x and y into the formula for the slope that we have?
Mm-hmm.
That's going to, does that give us?
The only confusing thing here, I think, is that this is not y in the traditional sense.
Right.
This is y prime. So this is what is going to be our slope. What we need to do is we need to put in x here. So we are going to say that the slope is going to be the slope at this point. And the reason we can do this is because it's a function. It's not like looping back on itself. Okay. When x is equal to 1, there is only one solution. Right?
Right. Yes. Yeah.
So we're going to say that y prime of x. We want y prime of 1, which is going to be the slope of the tangent line.
Yes.
At x equals 1. Is going to be equal to 2 over 1 plus 1 squared. So 2 over 2 squared, 2 over 4, 1 half. So what we've done here is we got the slope of the tangent line. And then we said at x equals 1, the slope is going to be equal to 1 half. Then the way that we would find the equation of the tangent line is we have a point and we have a slope, so we can find the equation to the line, right?
Yeah, this is, I was maybe jumping ahead a step unintentionally. Is this where we would apply y minus y sub 0 times x minus x sub 0?
Mm-hmm. So that equation is exactly, this is 1 half x minus 1, right?
Yes.
So we'll end up with I'll distribute that first. Y minus 1 is equal to 1 half x minus 1 half. We'll add 1 to both sides. So the equation of the tangent line to the curve at point y, or at point 1, 1, is going to be y is equal to 1 half x plus 1 half. And the big red flag here is that this y is different. I mean, like it refers to like the same, like, you know, like if I plot a point on x, I get a point on y, or like if I input x, I get out y, but they are different. We could call this, for instance, YA, and this is YB.
Well, and I guess, like, you know, thinking big picture too, the slope of the tangent varies as the point on the curve varies, which is why you start with y over 2x, you know.
Exactly.
And then I have y equals 1 half x. It seems really dumb, but I think the thing that tripped me up is what at the middle point where we had y prime of x equals 2 over x plus 1 squared.
Mm-hmm.
And you gave the point. You really only plugged x.
Yeah. That's, yeah. It, like, this is what makes it confusing, because if you have an f of x here, you're much less tempted to plug in your y here. Right. This is x, y. If this is f prime of x, you're much less tempted to say that's a 1. But because of the way that this problem was written. Yeah, so here we're just saying, because it's a function, we know that there's only one true value at, like, when x is equal to 1. Mm-hmm. So we're going to use that to find the slope. What's the slope?
Okay.
So yeah. Ta-da.
I follow.
All right. So let's try to do a couple problems from this next section, which is the trigonometric stuff. So it's section 2.4. in the main book. So in the main book, I'm on page 150. In your book, I'm not quite sure. It should just be right after.
Oh, you know, yeah, you're right. It is. It's a 3.3 derivatives of trigonometric function.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So let's start with number 1, and I think it should be the same for both of them. Sorry, I'm like switching between tabs right now, trying to make it consistent.
X squared sine x.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So there are a couple things going on here.
Sure.
What is the first thing that's going on here?
So, like, just talking out loud, I do know that So we're tasked with finding the derivative of this.
Yep.
I'm pretty sure that the x squared that's at the front of this does not get factored in the finding of the derivative. It goes out front, right?
Okay. Well, what's happening, what you're describing is if we had a function that looked like this, we would be able to just take the derivative of the sine of x and keep 4 as a constant because 4 is a constant.
Sure.
But right here, that looks like an x. I'm sorry, that's a constant. What is happening here is that we have another variable.
Okay.
So we need to keep track of which ones are constants and which ones are variables. So if we break it up and we say that we have a function right here and we have a function right here, and they're multiplied by one another. We have this function times this function.
We can do the same thing we did earlier where we break it out into like a...
Yep. Except we won't be using the quotient rule, we'll be using the product rule.
Right, okay.
So I'll call this g of x is equal to x squared. What is g prime?
This would be 2x.
And then I have h of x is equal to sine x. So h prime of x is equal to.
Do you remember this one? This is cosine x.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so our product rule is going to look something like this. If we're trying to take the derivative of g times h, we'll end up with g prime h plus h prime g.
Yes.
Excuse me. All right, so we build it. We have f prime of x, which is equal to g prime times h. G prime is 2x, h will be sine x plus h prime, which is cos x, times g, which is x squared. So this whole thing is going to turn out to be 2x sine x plus x squared cos x. So, what about, let's do number, for you, for both of us, actually, it's number 5.
The answer, by the way, that's the final answer for that.
Yeah, this is the final answer. There's no way to simplify that down. And as, like, you'll get a lot of answers that look like this, that are just long strings of variables, and it'll be messy. Unfortunately, finding derivatives is pretty messy.
I was trying to think back to like the the different trigonometric
I don't think
it can be simplified yet, but if it's it can't be, I guess that's fine.
Okay. So for 5, we have f of x is equal to secant theta tan theta. So what do we have here?
So I guess we could just set up g of x equal to secant.
Okay.
Secant theta.
Then what would g prime be?
Oh, bugger. See, I have the
sine yep.
and cosine ones from
The sine and the cosine ones are the super easy ones. The rest of them are annoying as hell. So
they're like there's I look for devices to remember them and I
So it'll be secant theta times tan theta. So then what else do we have?
So we could just do like h of x, I guess.
Or h of theta, I guess. Yeah, I totally did them the other one too.
Tan theta.
And do you remember what this derivative is? It is secant, I think, squared theta. Pretty sure. Okay. So then what rule are we going to use to solve this? So we've divvied it up into two functions. How are they related?
So, I mean, this could just be the product.
Yep, because we're multiplying them. Okay. So let's say f prime of x is equal to, have it written down up there. So this will be secant theta times secant squared theta. So that's gh prime. So I'm swapping it up a little bit, but I can do that because it's addition instead of subtraction.
Yeah.
So it'll just be plus, and now it'll be secant theta tan theta times, I just have to make sure I get this right,
tan theta.
Tan theta. So I'm going to simplify this. This is theta, not x. So this will be
I think I see where this is going.
Do you want to tell me or?
Sorry, yeah. I just feel like I'm interrupting.
No, that's fine. This is like a collaborative effort. Sure, okay. There's no interrupting that's happening here.
So for the sake of not having like secant to the power of 3 theta, we could actually take it's kind of like two steps in one, I guess. We could take secant theta out and then have secant squared theta in parentheses plus tan squared theta.
Sweet.
Right. And I can't remember if that is a if that's a thing. I'm sorry.
Terminology like a yeah. Sorry, again, this is like not necessarily my strong suit. Okay, so it's one, sorry, tan squared theta is equal to theta.
I knew it was opposite of like sine.
Yeah, it's a little bit different. So we could say that this is secant theta, and this is 1 plus tan squared theta plus tan squared theta, which we could just write as 2 tan squared theta. Or we could say that this is what? Secant theta. This would be secant theta, secant squared theta. That would be plus secant squared theta minus 1. So that would be 2 secant squared theta minus 1.
So are we like reconverting back?
Mm-hmm. So I could say that this is tan squared theta equals secant squared theta minus 1.
Just doing the opposite one from what we
did. Yeah. So both of these would be considered correct answers.
Okay. That's pretty much as far as it can go.
Yeah. I would consider this a correct answer.
Like 2 secant?
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't do that. And if I was taking an open-ended test, that I would be.
Sure. Like,
I would stop here. Yeah, I don't. It's not necessary to move on. I don't think, unless they want it in terms of, I don't know, one specific. However, that being said, these are multiple choice exams.
Yes.
So it's important to be able to recognize that all of these things are the same answer, and yet one of them may appear.
Right.
So.
They just might have to tweak what I have.
Yeah, tweak what you have to make sure that it can fit in the bounds of what the answer looks like.
Yeah.
Okie doke. Let's do. Sorry, I'm trying to make sure that I have problems that show up in your book.
Things that look very different. Like, we can ramp it up.
Okay.
Just for the sake of, like,
find a super difficult problem.
Yeah, in like, just so I'm talking out loud to someone else. Instead of debating in my head, like, I think maybe part of the struggles I've had is, like, I've followed a lot of the groundwork that we've set up in, like, learning how to apply these rules to basic to basic functions. Then when like I get to the quizzes, it's like it took that basic, like, you know, find the function of 2x squared, and then it's like I said earlier, it's like find the function of like sine squared theta plus the quantity of 1 over x plus 1 squared all divided by, like, it takes it up like 10 levels. And I'm like, okay, I've lost how to apply my rule.
Let's try something like, let's see, is this in, yes it is. I think this is your number 13 and also the number 13 in the book. Do you want to try this one?
Is this y equals t sine t over 1 plus t? Okay. Sure.
So this is a little bit of both the last section and the section that we're in now with the trig. So what do you see here? Break it down for me.
All right. So, well, before I would have said, okay, we have the quotient rule, and we do, but we can break this down, I'm guessing, into like an f of x, g of x.
I see three functions.
All right.
Right?
Okay, I'm sorry. We have t and sine t and 1 plus t. Okay, so we will have to set up three functions, I guess?
Yep.
Okay.
So we just need to make sure that we know how all of these are, you know, interrelated.
Okay.
So I would start working from the outside in. I would say that I have a quotient rule, right? And my quotient rule is going to require me to find, we'll call it J of T, which is equal to T sine T.
Okay.
And I need to find H of T, which is 1 plus T. And I can do this really easy. I can just say that the derivative of 1 plus t is 1. But I run into an issue here with this j of t that I have, because I'm going to need to use the product rule in order to find this derivative.
Okay.
So what I did here was I just broke it down. I have three functions. I'm going to start working from the outside in because I know I want to use the quotient rule to get my final answer. But in order to find the derivative of this top function, I need to use the product rule.
So we broke it down to two pieces, and we're going to break one of those pieces into two pieces.
Yes, exactly. So if I have J of T is equal to T sine T, then I can say that I have F of T is equal to T. So f prime of t is equal to 1. And then I have g of t and g prime of t. So this is sine t. And just what is the derivative of the sine of t?
Cosine t.
Yep.
Sorry, I don't know how powerful my microphone is, but my dog is speaking to me in the background.
No, that's good. I mean, okay. So we have j prime of t, which is equal to, how do I set up a product rule?
Oh, right. Okay, so we're going to do, we're going to have, in this case, f prime times g plus f times g prime.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So f prime times g plus f times g prime. And I can simplify that into j prime of t is equal to sine t plus t cos t. So I'll put that up here. And now I have to put it together with my H, which is happening right here. I'm trying to find a color that I haven't used yet. So in order to find Y prime of T, I need to use the quotient rule. And what is the quotient rule again, just in terms of J and H?
Okay, so this one, this is the one that you actually have to remember because you're subtracting one from another. So if we're doing, okay, so we're doing J and H, so it's J H prime, like J times H. Correct?
I think it's J prime H.
J prime H, okay. Minus J H prime
over
H squared.
Yeah. Let me quick check that, I guess. It is, yes. So, yeah. So the first one, the one that's in the numerator, the first one is the one that you take the derivative of. Okay. So because J is in the numerator, it's J prime times H.
Okay.
Okay. So let's put it together. So we have Y of T. We know what this is going to kind of start looking like. J prime. What did we say J prime was? Yep.
G prime ended up being sine t plus t cos t.
Awesome. And then that's times h.
H, which is 1 plus t.
So minus j times h prime.
So for just j, t sine t?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right.
And h prime is 1 over h squared.
Okay. Oh, yeah, 1 plus t, or 1 plus t squared.
Mm-hmm. So then we can distribute like this. So this will be sine t plus t cos t plus t sine t plus t squared cos t, right?
Yeah.
I did that right.
Yeah, I was actually.
And I will screw up basic algebra. Like that will happen. That will happen undoubtedly.
I mean, when I'm doing that too, I always have to remember, do you do the FOIL method, first, outer, inner, last?
Yeah. Yes, I think that's what I did this time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so I was following and I was like, yeah, so I think that's, I think we're good.
Okay, and then minus T sine T.
Yeah.
All over 1 plus T squared. And so I have a plus T sine T and a minus T sine T, so I can just get rid of those.
Yeah.
And my final result is going to be sine T plus T cos T plus T squared cos T over 1 plus T squared.
Yeah. That's another one of those ones that, like, you think for a second, like, how can I make that, how can I make that simpler? But I...
Yeah, it's like, I wouldn't even try.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't have that energy. Okay.
Okay.
So is that kind of like a more difficult, like, step up type problem?
Yeah, because it's like, right, because we're
mm-hmm.
not only breaking it down into like two functions and then doing it from there. It's like the one function has to be broken down further.
Okay.
So that's, yeah, that's a good framework for helping to figure out.
All right. Do you want to do some problems from 2.5 for the chain rule?
Yeah, I think that was one that, I mean, listen, all of it is.
Yeah.
Like, all of it was intense. So the chain rule, yes.
This section or this like week is like a time where a lot of material is just thrown at you guys.
Yeah.
And it's really quite difficult. I know people have struggled in the past. This is just from my experiences, like leading GSGs, differentiating between when they should use the chain rule versus when they should use the product rule. Because a lot of times it looks like you should use one and then it all of a sudden, like, you're not using that one. So my best advice when you're trying to figure out whether you should use like the chain rule versus the product rule is to literally just like start trying things. Break down the function, say like, I have a function here. I have a function here. Are they being multiplied together? Do I have a function within a function? The more you break down a function, the easier it's going to be for you to kind of understand what's happening.
And I think that's maybe what I wasn't doing, is like when you look at something and it seems so difficult and you just start trying to work it with each component down first, I think that was probably a big source of my frustration.
Okay. Yeah. So like if we have something like this, and I think that the question here is really just to like break it down.
Okay.
So how would I break down this type of a function? I'm looking for functions within functions.
Can we do like we have 1 to the 1/3 and 4x to the 1/3?
We can't really do that. Just like if we were to have like 4 plus 3x squared, we couldn't just say this is 4 squared plus 3x. Squared, right?
It would be the quantity 4 plus 3x times the quantity 4 plus 3x.
Yeah. So what we're looking for is like a function like within a function. Okay. And the way that is going to be easiest, I think, is to identify like what these functions are. And I, like, there are kind of two ways to approach this. And I usually go from like the inside out. I like look for stuff that's inside of parentheses and then see what's acting on it. For instance, I have a 1 plus 4x here and I have something that's acting on that, which is this 1 to the power of 1/3.
Yep.
And so I would say that I have like u of x, which is equal to 1 plus 4x. And then I could say that I have a function y of u, where u is to the 1/3.
Oh, I remember this.
Yeah. So you can also work from like the outside in, and you can say, hey, I see to the power here oftentimes powers are acting on like the, like multiple like things like this. And so there's kind of two ways of approaching it, but the best way I think is to just like explicitly write out, I have this function U of X, and then I have this function Y of U, and these are what they look like.
Sure, yeah.
I could also say that this is Y of U of X, because U is a function of X.
Right, because we're kind of breaking it down from the inside out.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of. Okay. Yeah.
All right. Do you want to try doing a problem with chain rule?
Yeah, sure. I mean, sure.
Well, let's do it. Let's start with number, I have number 7. I think it's the same in this book.
We're not in the same.
Oh, no, we're different. I'm sorry. I'm in section 2.5 right now. I think it's 3.4 in this other book. So 7, which is f of x, is equal to the quantity 5x to the 6 plus 2x cubed to the 4th. So previously, if I had given you this in a different section, you would have either tried to multiply it all out or like turn it into like a product rule type thing, which would have been insanely complicated and really annoying. Okay. Now,
if you try to take that quantity times itself 4 times.
Now we have the chain rule that we can work with. So, first things first, let's identify which function is inside and which function is outside.
Sure. So, do we actually have two functions inside?
We do. No. We do. But they're added together. And this is acting, this 4 here is acting on both of them, like, in the same manner.
Okay.
Right? Because you're right about us having two functions inside. When we were thinking, like, if we have a function that looks like this, if we just had this not to the 4th, this would be really easy to differentiate because we can just add the derivatives together, right?
Sure, you can, like, you can handle each one of them separately.
Yeah, so because it's easy in that respect, we're just going to, like, treat them, like, together.
Okay.
The reason we're doing this is because we want to make this simpler to take a derivative of.
Okay.
So let's call this right here. We can say that we have a function h in the inside. So h of x is equal to 5x to the 6 plus 2x cubed. And then h prime of x we can find really easily. What is h prime of x?
Oh, sure. Okay. All right. So we have 6 times 5, 30. So 30x to the 5th plus 6x to the 2nd.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then we have this function that is, we'll call it g. But it's not g of x.
Right.
This function is going to be g of h. So g of h is going to equal h to the 4th.
Right, okay.
And the reason I wrote it like this is because I don't want to think about anything that's happening within h right now. I just want to worry about g.
Sure, sure.
So g prime is going to be what?
Oh, it's going to be 3h. Or I'm sorry, 4h to the 3rd.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So then we have to ask ourselves, what is the chain rule? What does the chain rule look like? So we have something that looks like this. We have a function within a function, g of h of x. And the derivative of that is going to be g prime of h of x times h prime. Right?
Yeah. Yeah, that was a difficult one to kind of
because we're taking the derivative of the outside function and then we're applying it to just regular h of x. And then we can't forget that we also need to take the derivative of the inside function.
So we're basically multiplying the two kind of the two pieces we broke apart.
So yeah.
So I mean, almost like what you just said.
Yeah. Note that.
Side times basically the derivative of the whole thing.
So note that we are not using just regular g here. That's something that is the difference between like a product rule and, I mean, like there's a lot of things that are different fundamentally, but in this equation, we don't have a regular g. We just have g prime.
Right. So you're saying in the derivative, there is no, like there will not be a g of h.
Yeah, so we're not going to be using g of h here.
Okay.
So f prime of x, we're going to put it together. G prime of h is going to be what?
G prime of h of x.
Mm-hmm. So let's start with g prime of h.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. Okay, g prime of h is 4h to the third.
Yep. Then we can go ahead and put h in here, right?
So, okay, yeah, so h of x is just 5x to the sixth plus 2x to the third.
Mm-hmm. And so then we'll multiply this by h prime of x.
Right, so our h prime of x is 30x to the fifth plus 6x squared.
Awesome. So then we can, prime of x is equal to 4 I can, a lot of times people put this out front when they rewrite it. So they'll say it is like 4 times 30x to the fifth plus 6x squared is equal to f prime of x. And they'll just put it at the end here. But you can kind of see like how it breaks down, how we like are taking this type of derivative, like it's of the same form of the power rule. We're applying the power rule here, but we have to remember that something's happening on the inside as well. So why don't we quick do something. This isn't like in the book or something, anything like that. Mm-hmm. Let's look at something that looks like this. If I had the function, that looks like this. I can't remember if in this class, sorry, I do two different versions of calc. In one of my versions of calc, I know that they just tell you outright, just bump this outside. But the way that that happens is by using the chain rule. So like, would you know how to like start solving this?
When there's something before, like, you know, where theta would be, so like x, so like sine 3x,
mm-hmm.
that part gets a little.
Okay. Easy thing to remember is if you don't have any variables like or any other wonky stuff that's happening in the middle here, you can just say that this is going to be like you can pull like the constant out and say that this is going to be 3 times cos 3x. So the constant stays in, it's just like added on the outside. That's like a general rule for constants in the middle of stuff like this. However, the way we can prove that. Yeah, so I think there's like a general rule where if you have like f prime of x is equal to sine ax, then or f of x, excuse me. I don't know why I have prime here. Sorry.
Okay, no, that's
yeah. then f prime of x is going to equal a sine or a cos.
Sure, okay.
So this is like a rule. That has been like established, and in some textbooks they explicitly say like this is what it looks like. So then I could say f double prime of x is equal to negative a squared sine ax, and you just like add add-on like that. So this is a rule that is explicitly written in some books. This book, it might not be explicitly written in. So we can figure out exactly why this is the case using the chain rule. Okay. We can say that we have two functions here, and one of them is like they're nested in one another. What is the first function?
We're going off the curve. Oh, wait. Are we doing the new example? Oh, I'm sorry. Hold on. Let's go back for a second. That was the final answer for...
Oh, yeah. This is the final answer here. This is done.
Okay. I thought in... I remember an example using the chain rule. I remember them distributing the exponent of the quantity, like the exponent outside of the one quantity. So I thought it was going to break down further.
Oh, no, I would not do that.
Oh, okay.
That would just make it messy.
I do remember, I'm sorry. Okay, scratch that. Okay, that's, let's stay with that. Because once again, the exponent outside of a quantity doesn't mean just to distribute the exponent.
Yeah.
Okay.
You could distribute this 4 if you wanted to.
Okay. Sorry. That's the answer for that. Okay. So we're down here.
Mm-hmm.
So we're tasked with determining the derivative of this.
Yeah. So let's find the derivative of the sine of 3x.
Okay. So going off of that rule that may or may not be explicitly stated. So if the derivative of sine x cosine x, and if there's a coefficient we slap it out front, then this would be 3 cosine 3x.
Yep, that's exactly it. Okay. However, we could figure this out using the chain rule too.
Okay.
So this is kind of like a proof, of concept of like why this rule, this general like may or may not be written in your book rule, works.
Okay.
So you don't have to do this every time if you kind of like remember like what's happening here. This is like one of those few times that I won't actually write the chain rule out explicitly if I have something that looks like this.
Okay.
However, you can say that this internal function we'll call h of x is equal to 3x.
Okay.
So h prime of x is equal to 3. And then I have this external function, which is going to be, we'll call g of h is equal to sine of h, so g prime of h is equal to cosine of h. And then I can put it together just like I did before. I'll have f prime of x is equal to cos of h. So h will be 3x times 3, or h prime of x. So I use this exact same g prime of h of x. So
h of x times h prime of x. Got it. And so then you can just put the 3 out in front of the cosine. Okay.
So what's really happening with this general rule is the chain rule is being applied.
Right. So instead of like I like that more than, you know, if somewhere it just said like, hey,
yeah.
Whenever you take the derivative of sine and a coefficient of x, just slap the coefficient out front. Like instead of just saying that's a rule, seeing how it is.
Yeah, it this way, in case you forget it,
yes.
You can always go back to what you know because you'll have to remember the chain rule.
Yes. Okay. Got it.
All right. Do you want to? Let's try another one.
All right.
Let's try. Let's see if there are similar numbers. All right, so you're 25. For everyone else in the book, it's going to be 21. And so that is going to be the function g of u is equal to u cubed minus 1 over u cubed plus 1 all to the 8. So what are you seeing here?
All right. I'm seeing the, at the very least, at the very least, the two functions within the so u cubed minus one and u cubed plus one.
Okay, we'll call that f of u. So f prime of u. I tend to just find them right away because why not? It's going to be
3u squared.
Mm-hmm. All right. And then we'll call this h of u, which is equal to u cubed plus 1. So h prime of u is equal to.
That's just 3u squared.
Okay. Then what do we have?
Then we need
we can rewrite this right now. So we'll call this f of u over h of u to the 8. So if we have something that looks like this, seems real grody, right? We don't want that. So let's, instead of calling that f of u and h of u, let's call f over h equal to j. So j of u. So now we have g of u is equal to j to the 8th.
All right.
So, then what we would have to do is we would have to say we need a j, which is a function of u, is equal to, we said it was f over h. So j is going to be equal to u cubed minus 1 over u cubed plus 1. This is our internal, this is j.
Yeah.
And then we need to say that we have g of j is equal to j to the 8. Or let's not call this g. So, I'm running out of letters.
Yeah, no, I'm right. So, okay, so my observation at this point through the problem is this is kind of just, I don't know. Does it, like, do you think that it helps having, like, it almost seems kind of like 5 degrees of separation in that, like.
Yeah, what I would have done is I would have not started with this F and H. Okay. I would have started with the chain rule and then worked my way inward. So how I would have started this off is by saying, yeah, I see that quotient and I see it's going to be a problem. So I would have started off by saying, I have this function and I'm going to call this function, we're going to call it j. So j of u is equal to u cubed minus 1 over u cubed plus 1.
Okay.
I also have this function, which we're going to call, we have an f, we have an h, we have a g. We'll call it w. Is of j is equal to j to the 8th. W prime of j is equal to 8j to the 7th. And my thing is that I have this function that is w of j of u that I'm trying to figure out. So my outside function, the one that's going to give me the true answer to what this derivative is going to be found using the chain rule. So I'm going to say that g prime of u is going to be equal to w prime of j of u times j prime of u. Because my outer function, what I have to find the answer, I'm just thinking of this as like one block in the inside here right now. just like I did earlier when I had like 5x squared plus 6x cubed or whatever.
Okay. Yeah, so this is like one of those times where like we're like, if you wanted to, you could have broken it down far further, but I think it gets too confusing.
Yeah, well, we're gonna have to do that to solve eventually. Sure. Because our issue is that we don't have a J prime right now that we need. So J prime of U needs to be found using the quotient rule, which we can do right here. We said that we had F of U equaling U cubed minus 1. F prime of U is equal to 3 U squared. So that's why I would have started on the outside. Okay. Here. Because identifying these functions is like really well and good, but it's made it a little unnecessarily complicated right away. So then we have h prime of u, which is 3u squared. And then when we set up a quotient rule problem, we're going to say that j prime of u is going to be equal to f prime times h minus h prime times f over h squared. So we can put it together. J prime of u is equal to, and stop me if you have any questions.
We're getting to that point where I'm trying to backtrack and follow which variable of u and which variable prime of u.
Like, yeah, unfortunately, I've been trying to color code.
No, that's fine. No, and like I think this is just something that like, for me is going to take, like, unfortunately, is going to take time to understand, because like it has to break down to so many different levels before you can get back to the issue at hand.
Yeah. And that's why I tend to write everything down.
Sure.
So the reason I write everything down is not because I enjoy writing this much, but because it helps me to be able to keep track of what happens. Mm-hmm. So do you see what I just did?
So, okay. So I'm trying to formulate into like telling myself how to follow, like basically repeating how to follow along.
Mm-hmm.
The J prime of U is something we didn't have. That's what we're finding out. And the J prime of U is basically the numerator and the denominator, like the numerator and the denominator split into functions and primes of those functions.
Yep.
Put into J
prime. So yeah. So if we look at this as like problem, like step-by-step problem solving, we break this down as much as we can. We say we need to use the chain rule to find G prime of U. We need to use the chain rule to find the answer to this problem. I broke it up into two functions, J and W, where J is nested within W.
Yes.
And then I tried to solve the problem, and I ran into a brick wall. And that was that I didn't know how to find the derivative of J without using the quotient rule. So I just went ahead and I took a little aside and I said, I'm going to use the quotient rule to find J prime of U. And now that I have found J prime of U, I can bring it back up.
Right, okay. It took me a second. I do see, yes, I'm following this a little bit better now. Okay.
So I'm just going to distribute and clean up what's happening right here. Mm-hmm. So that'll be 3u to the fifth plus 3u squared. This is a minus, not a plus. So that'll be minus 3u to the fifth minus 3u squared. Is that correct? No, plus 3u squared. Ooh, I was like, that's wrong. So there's a minus right here. Over u cubed plus 1. So j prime of u will be, we have this set cancels. It'll be 6u squared over u cubed plus 1.
Is u cubed plus 1 squared?
Yes.
Okay.
Squared. Squared. All right. So now I have my j prime, I have my j, I have my w, and I have my w prime. So I can go ahead and put together w prime of j of u times j prime of u.
Got it.
So in order to do that, I'm going to say I have g prime of u is equal to, I have my w, so my w, or my w prime, excuse me, which is 8 times j to the 7th. And I know that my j, which is all the way up here, I can do this in light blue. My j is going to be u cubed minus 1 over u cubed plus 1.
Okay.
And then I'm going to have to multiply it by my j prime, which is right here. So that's right here in this darker blue, which is 6u squared over u cubed plus 1 squared. So my final answer is just going to be me simplifying this a little bit.
Sure. Okay.
So I can just loop this in. I can multiply it in with this first one. So that'll be 48 u squared over u cubed plus 1 squared times.
And so that's pretty much like that's our.
Yeah, I wouldn't simplify that down any further. Usually these problems are not really worth it to simplify that much.
Yeah, I've seen from the multiple choice, like that's pretty much how they look.
So
yeah, that's fine. Okay. I actually like I can follow it in the moment. I think and I'm sure you probably advocate for this, but like practicing it as much as possible.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the best way to learn this material is just to do a million practice problems.
I'm fine with that. Because like I follow what you did now, but like ask me tomorrow.
Yeah, that is the problem. Following it and doing it is like a whole different thing.
Yeah, but I do like I'm still with you.
All right. Yeah. Do you want to try one more?
Sure. We'll do. Let's do one more. How long do you run? Do you run these for?
Usually for about an hour is what they take up.
I'm sorry if I took you.
No, no, for sure. Okay. I mean, like I set off a huge chunk of time. So, like a huge chunk of time for. Sorry, something is blinking. I don't know what's blinking on my screen. It's like, I don't know. It must be the recording. I hope the recording makes it. Sometimes it doesn't. I just like go into the cloud and there's nothing.
No, after 2 hours.
I mean, like that's whatever. I guess.
Yeah, sure.
I see what's happening. Maybe. I don't know. Okay. So I don't see the problem that I want to do in this other book.
I'll do whatever.
So I'm just going to write it down. And it is going to be, this is going to be 2.5. We're going to do problem 25. Which is h of theta is equal to the tangent of theta squared sine theta. Okay. Sorry, I need to look anymore. Let's do that. Let's do it.
Oh, hey, there we go.
All right, so I want you to walk me through this.
Okay, so I guess we can break this down into, we have I guess the two units. We have the one inside the parentheses, which is theta squared sine theta.
Okay, we'll call that G.
Sure, yeah, we'll start with G, seems popular.
And then what's our other one?
The other one, I guess would be the whole entire thing, which is, well, can we is this where we basically make a variable for that one? So like, say like tan of something is equal to that.
Yep. So what we would say is we have this function w, and what is this variable going to be? We already decided what it was.
So it's, well, theta, because we're dealing with.
When we're going to break this down, we're going to have, this is going to be equal to the tan of some variable. What is this variable?
Okay, because we said g of theta is that,
so yep.
The w of g is tan of g. Okay, all right, got it. Okay, that's our
sweet
breakdown within the breakdown. Okay.
All right, so next step. We're using the chain rule in which we have ddx of w of g of theta is equal to w prime of g of theta times g prime of theta.
Okay. All right, good. So, like the previous one, we don't know what g prime of theta is yet.
Do we know what w prime is?
W prime is secant g tan g? No.
That is the derivative of the secant.
Okay,
You were
squared.
Yes, there you go. Okay. Secant squared of g.
Yes.
Okay, so then we try to find, as you said earlier, g prime of theta.
All right, so
we hit a rock wall.
You're right, we don't know what that is yet because we have two components of that that we need to figure out. Okay. So I guess we can just, what don't we have?
Let's rewrite it over here.
Okay, all right.
So now we're pretending this is a whole separate problem. I don't care about what's happening over here with W.
Yep. I'm with you. So we got to figure this one out. Okay, so we have two things we have to figure out from this one is the prime of theta squared.
Let's break it down first into what rule are we going to use and what two functions do we have.
Okay, this I imagine would be the product.
Yep, you're right, we are using the product rule. So the product rule is going to look like this, and we're going to have a function f times a function. Used h, we used g. Well, let's use j, I guess. I like j. So this is going to be f prime j plus j prime f.
Right, okay.
Product.
All right, so. Oh, okay. Sorry, I think the theta was tripping me out. So can we establish, so we need to establish what, like what these primes are first, and then we can into that.
First things first, what functions do I have? So if I'm splitting it into an f and a j, I have an f of theta, right?
Yep. So let's say f of theta is, let's just be like theta squared.
Yep. So what would then j of theta be?
So j of theta would be sine theta.
Mm-hmm. So What's next?
Okay, so we can do f prime of theta. Would just be, if we treat it like a variable, it's just 2 theta.
Mm-hmm.
And then j prime of theta cosine theta.
Awesome. Okay. So in order to find g prime, we've got to put the pieces together.
Yes.
So f prime is...
Oh, sorry. So we have 2 theta.
Times... Zero and a theta. Oops.
2 theta times sine theta plus cosine theta times theta squared.
Okay. Awesome. So we have that. That's good. Right. I'm going to move this a little bit, offset it down so that I can write it out fully. All right. So now we have G, G prime, W, and W prime. How am I going to put this together to find my answer? H okay. prime.
So we know what okay, so we can take the primary derivative we're trying to find out, the W prime of G of theta. We can plug that in now, right?
So we've got secant squared of g, because we're using this function, right? Up here?
Right.
So secant squared of what?
Secant squared of g theta squared sine theta?
Because I'm just trying to put this in terms of theta. I could just write g here if I wanted to, but at some point in time I would need to put it in terms of g of theta.
Sure.
So this is just going to be theta squared. Here, I'll put it in blue. So it'll be theta squared sine theta. And then it'll be times.
Two theta sine theta plus theta squared cosine theta.
So that is going to be our answer. It's going to look something like this. And I would not go anywhere near simplifying it.
Okay, good. Thank you. Let's look at this. Like, all right, what's the next step?
This parenthesis stuff might be out front. That's fine. I wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole. This is the answer. That's good enough.
Good. I'm fine with that.
Okay. Do you have any questions about chain rule, product rule, quotient rule, finding derivatives?
Oh boy, I don't think so. I think I'm at the point where
It's been almost 2 hours, so I'm sure you're fried.
Yeah, and by the way, I've also been, doing stuff today, too, so it's, yeah. But, this is all breaking it down for me like that and giving me the steps where you, break it down further and get breaking down the separate steps.
Yeah, everything can be broken down into, there, we're only going to be using functions that you know. So everything can be broken down into something that you know. Mm-hmm. And if you can break it down into enough parts, you can understand all the parts individually and then try to put them together to make the whole.
Yeah.
That's kind of always been my strategy. Also, I write everything down.
Yes. No,
that's my other strategy.
Sure. Well, I'm not planning to try and kind of keep any of these things temporarily in my head while I compute other things. So
oh, I tried to do that at the beginning. I really did try. I was like, I can just do this in my head, and it didn't work out for me. So I'm glad that you're taking the right road from the get-go.
Well, and like I didn't know exactly what to expect with calculus, and trigonometry was like, I enjoy math, but that doesn't mean that I'm a savant at it.
Yeah, that's like,
trigonometry was the first experience I had in something that was very challenging.
Yeah.
To understand, and I didn't know what to expect with calculus. I heard people say that like calculus uses trig, but it's different.
Well, yeah. So a lot of what you'll be experiencing in terms of like the trig that you'll see in this class is like, we'll use like these trig functions, we'll like find their derivatives, we'll interact with them in that way, but we won't actually be like using trig in the traditional trig sense.
Yeah, like the way that the way that a class based around trigonometry does, like
yeah,
and triangles and everything being
like, yeah, that's like not something that we really deal with. Sure. Here. So I'm
kind of wishing for that back at this point.
Yeah, this is a whole different beast, whole different approach to things, but thank you for coming and staying the whole time.
Yeah, I mean I'm not like I'm very humble, but like I've never done a tutoring. I've never needed to do a tutoring before, and so that,
well, I am here every week.
Every Sunday?
Every Sunday at 5 p.m.
Yeah, and so do you like, it's just the previous week's worth of...
Yeah, I usually, I like set up like here on like Sundays, and I do like the last week's worth of material. I'm just kind of like working through problems and that sort of thing. If you want to send me questions like in the middle of the week that I can incorporate into this, that's like totally cool, and I'll definitely like put those on the list of like things to cover. And yeah, that's basically what I do here.
That's awesome. Much needed. I'm surprised, like, listen, I cannot believe that like everyone else in the class is like, yeah, this stuff is easy.
Yeah. I was in the same boat when I was learning calc for the first time. I was like so overwhelmed. So it's not easy material.
It's not.
And anyone who says it's easy doesn't get it.
Yes.
Or is a savant.
Yes.
That's always a possibility.
Yes.
But yeah. Okay. Yeah.
I don't have any I couldn't even formulate a question. Just thank you very much.
Thank you for coming. Have a wonderful evening.
You too. I will tune in next week.
Yes. Thank you so much for attending.
I will be here next week.
Awesome.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
I will let you go for the night then.
Oh, that's all right. Yeah, you too.
Have a wonderful evening.
You as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.